So I named my talk originally An Incredible Miracle. And after I've been here and listening to the other 11 guys, I think we could all name our stories Incredible Miracles. Because the journeys everybody's been on is just incredible. How bad was it? Well, a little overview. I grew up in Detroit, Michigan in the volatile times following World War II. I was the second of four kids. I'm going to tell you about the two big secrets I used to keep to myself during those Detroit days and for a long time after, before I had the good fortune years later to ask for help from those skilled at helping my disorder in the ways that I needed help. My wife, highly qualified therapists, friends, Alcoholics Anonymous, adult children of alcoholics, and my own intense desire to learn. My first perpetrator told me for several years that I would die if I told anyone what he did, so I never did, until I was almost 60, and then only in parts of my story at a time. I had told myself, I can't die until I die, I can't tell until I die, I can't tell until I die, and I believed it. Well, today, I'm telling all of you my whole story. But let me talk more about my secret number one. I have dissociative identity disorder, DID. It used to be called multiple personalities. I have a total of 9 alters, 9 different parts of the same person, me. This came about from the very early and chronic trauma of living with a rageaholic drinking mother, a drunk, absent father, a totally isolated, closed up, incestuous Irish Catholic family. And at 6 years, being a child in an uncle's pedophile pornographic film business, at 11 years old, being in an incestuous cult-like sect group run by another uncle, as well as sex abuse by a neighbor, at 13, being forced to start having more sex with my mother that continued until I left the house, at 14, my priest starts abusing me, and many, many episodes of sex with adult men with strangers. And the ongoing chronic neglect of my fundamental needs as a child. The neglect was so bad that I read at the first grade level in the 6th grade. And by the time I tried a college writing class, I had to take it 3 times before I could pass it. And my parents never noticed I couldn't read or write all along the way. My father was arrested for theft when I was 14. And we had to learn to live on welfare for more than 2 years. And my mother forced me to become even more sexual with her. I had become the husband, father, surrogate until I left the house. When I was 18, I was walking down a street in Detroit and started to pass an Air Force recruiting office. I hadn't thought about it before, but it instantly occurred to me that if I joined, I could escape my mother. In 30 minutes, I committed my life to the next 4 years. Certainly long enough, I thought, to get the daily terror of my mother out of my system. On the flight to the basic training base in San Antonio, Texas, I experienced the most transformative day of my life. All the years of abuse completely disappeared from my memory. All my abuse memories, all the perpetrators, completely gone, a total blank. It's called dissociative amnesia, one of the characteristics of DID. And I can tell you, DID is a very powerful, very frustrating, very complex, very disorienting disorder. Forgetting is the first part of my story, and remembering is the second part. All the memories I forgot returned with a vengeance when I was 55 years old. And for the next few years, all hell broke loose for me. 37 years had passed, and it was the second most transformative day of my life. It was then that the reality of my early life, the memories, started to come out slowly and painfully, and my life started to slide downhill. I was totally overwhelmed. I didn't remember anything for all those years, and then horrific memories start to come over the emotional dam I had built years earlier to keep the memories out. My life realities disappeared. I was in a total panic. I felt that my choices were to give in and hide for the rest of my life, or commit suicide, which stayed front and center in my conscious mind for years, or try with a will to understand what happened and what I could do about it. Only with the support of my wife was I able to move toward the possible help, help that I could not seek on my own. My mind had melted, and in a matter of weeks, it had gone from sharp and hard charging to something much more like oatmeal. I had very scary hallucinations and many old, distinct smells that I hadn't smelled since I left home. I was never so scared or confused. In a truly incredible story all by itself, almost a miracle, I then found the expert therapist who was to help guide me for the next 18 years. I have a big story over many years and with many abusers, but you know what? My surviving and recovering are much the same as many of you. It isn't so much what was done to us, but how it affected us. Without ever knowing the what in every man's story, the how of recovery has a lot in common. We all have a seat in the same boat. In the years after the memory started to take a clear shape, even with the great therapy, life has been very hard at times, even in good periods. It can be a day by day by day process, and some days it's an inch by inch by inch process. It's a personal journey that moves forward with the help of others who are working for their recovery, like many of you, with friends, therapists, groups, reading, and learning constantly. The more I opened up to others, the more I was supported and the more strength I felt. I actually borrowed the great strength and thinking I could see in others because I wanted to be able to do things like they did, because I wanted to be able to think thoughts like they did, because they had healthy ways of thinking and behaving that I wanted to learn to do. It humbled me greatly to realize that I could not do it alone. I could not do it by myself, but realizing that actually saved my life. My self-centered self-reliance was hurting me, not helping me. I needed to find help and then to accept it. I looked at myself and what did I see? A relentless persistence to move forward in every way I could. Not just thinking that it's about abuse recovery, but more importantly, life recovery, all aspects of my life, the whole 360 degrees of my life. The more I could see the whole of me, the more encouraged and motivated I became, even when I had to see my progress through my own incredible pain. I was a poor academic student, but I wasn't dumb. One day I made a pledge to myself that for every day of the rest of my life in recovery, I would be less ignorant at the end of that day. The more I could learn, the more it would help me. Some of the examples from my beginning thinking: learning to accept even more of my own difficult and complex story, finding where I could get the specific kind of help and knowledge I needed, learning more about how recovery from sex abuse of men works, and paying attention to where my masculinity was threatened. And these are just a few. I was emotionally unstable for several years after my memories came out. My therapist helped me stabilize my emotions and cope with all the new needs I suddenly had on a daily basis. My behavior had put my job at risk, my retirement, and I didn't want to end up like my father. No retirement, no money, and a terrible sense of self. When I was a teenager, my mother used to scream at me, "You're just like your father, you're stupid." And she said this virtually every day until I left the house. This from a mother who was forcing me to have sex with her. Now, years later, I am committed to not be like my father. My DID is very stable now. I still switch occasionally. But in my early days, I was not able to predict which part of me would wake up in the morning. Maybe it would be one of the young children or a teenager or my abuse protector, whose name is Observer, or the part that opens up my intelligence, whose name is Performer. I would go to bed almost every night wondering who I was going to be when I woke up. Which one of the nine will I be today? But it didn't matter because I needed to keep my job and I had to go to work regardless. But once in the office, I would involuntarily switch at any time and another part of me would take over. I could be a smart boss or be found actually hiding, yes, actually hiding under my desk or wandering around as a scared little boy. I couldn't control it and it went on every day. Life with DID is very hard on me and hard on those around me who want to understand, love, and support me, like my wife of 46 years. DID is very complicated and creates life contradictions every day. For a long time, pain was present all the time, and I had to learn to create moments, periods of positive self-awareness, doing things I enjoyed. The more I tried to understand my family of origin, the abuse, my alcoholism, my DID, and how they fit together, I realized just how complicated my problem was. But the virtue of this thinking was that I could see my own big picture, and that helped me understand that it wasn't my fault. There wasn't a finish line in sight for me. There was and is only one day at a time. To help myself manage my recovery, I created some recovery tools, thinking of how can I learn and keep myself safe ideas, practical, doable ideas. I journaled almost every day, and as I did, I was learning to accept the brutal honesty of my life as I wrote. It told me that it was my responsibility to learn to self-manage the process of my own recovery. I learned that I can't wait for recovery to come to me. I had to go get it. The foundations of my toolkit are actions and ways of thinking. The goal of each was to try as hard as I could to understand it and apply the lessons I learned. Here are a few. I learned to let go of my end of the family rope. I stopped reacting to them as I had when I was a child. I slowly gave myself over to the therapy process. I had stopped drinking, and I slowly gave myself over to the AA way of thinking and living. I let AA help therapy, and therapy help AA. They combine marvelously. I slowly learned to be brutally honest with myself. I had to learn to listen. I had to learn to ask for help. I had to learn not to take anything about recovery for granted. I had to learn that it takes discipline to manage my self-recovery. Without discipline, I have already learned painfully that I will pay the price of regret. It's either discipline or regret. And I always remember the title of a book my therapist wrote. It's not you, it's what happened to you. My recovery has no perfection in it, no finish line. I have a lot of flaws. I don't have solutions for others. I only have the powerful feeling that I do not want to be defeated in my life by what was done to me. If I give in to my pain, to my isolation, to my secrets, to my fears, I will not succeed in managing my life. One thing I practice is turning around and looking back. I take pride in realizing how far I've come from being a victim. I'm still flawed. I'm a proud survivor of chronic sexual abuse who put in the hard work and is no longer the victim, no longer the scared child, but a forward-looking man who has come such a long distance, such a very, very long distance. It's all about my progress. It's not about my perfection. I've come so far that I really like myself. In our world, if that isn't recovery, I don't know what is. And all nine of my parts want you to know they are greatly relieved that I just told my story for the second time and I did not die. As we say in AA, don't quit before the miracle. Thanks.